Welcome to All Things Vanderpump. And this week we have the incredible Mark Cuban. I think most people have been watching him for years on Shark Tank. So we talk about the Dallas Mavericks. I got my education in cryptocurrency. And yeah, certainly it was a very interesting conversation. And then stick around for Kelty Knight from Lady Gang. She's going to fill me on some really juicy stuff. And then we have a very special guest that's totally unsuspecting. It's a prank call on Howie Mandel with his daughter. Sorry, Howie, I have to apologize in advance. You got to hear this. It's bloody hilarious. So let's go. So welcome to All Things Vanderpump. And I am talking with Mark Cuban, who is judge on Shark Tank, who you will know him so very well from, because I think you've been on that for like 9, 10 years, haven't you?
Yeah, thanks for having me, Lisa. It's been 10 years for me. It's going on 13 years for the show.
Wow. So you actually started in reality, albeit a very different forum, about the same time as I did, really. And it's really life-changing, isn't it? And I'm not sure that you're ever prepared for what you actually kind of experience until you're right in the middle of it.
No, you're absolutely right. I mean, no one, there's no training guide on how to go from being nobody knows you to a few people know you to everybody's in your business.
And talking about your business, I mean, there's so many upsides. For me, I know personally, it's given me an incredible platform for my charities. It's allowed me to speak at United Nations and, you know, go to Congress and, you know, co-write resolutions and things for my animal activism and things. And it's been incredibly beneficial to my business. But some of the kind of invasiveness of it, of being on a reality show, can be quite kind of jarring sometimes. You know, when people are writing about things, they think they know you. I have incredibly loyal supporters and have, for the most part, a very good experience. But how do you find, you know, do you sometimes get, like, are you the recipient of aggression or negativity that you find it difficult to deal with?
Yeah, I mean, look, it can be aggravating at times, particularly with my kids. I mean, you have to develop thick skin and, you know, there's just no way around it. And particularly with social media. I mean, literally, when you and I both got started, social media was minimal, right?
Exactly.
You know, Twitter was marginal at best. There was no Instagram, no Snapchat. It was, you know, it just wasn't to the scale that it is today. And so I don't think any of us knew what we were getting into. But over time, you know, you've got to just tell yourself the benefits outweigh the hassles. And I agree with you. I really think they do. It's created, it's created a great platform for me. It's allowed me to do things I never, ever thought I would be able to do. It's opened up my businesses for me. It's just, you know, at times it's annoying and you kind of feel like you're in the middle of the firestorm every now and then. But when you just, you know, take a step back, I think it's a net positive as well.
Yeah, absolutely. It's kind of, you know, you balance it out, really. But as you say, when I first started, I think it was just as Twitter began. And I don't think any of us really knew that Twitter would become almost like a judgment day. You know,
Whatever nobody did.
Yes, it's quite extraordinary.
I've been on there almost since the beginning. And in the early days of Twitter, it was like, hey, guess what I had for dinner?
Or it was quite gentle.
I just went and had 3 pieces of pizza. Oh, I feel fat.
I know.
It's just dumb stuff. And now look at it.
The past president took it to a whole new level. And I didn't want to see that. I didn't want to see somebody in the Oval Office having this kind of knee-jerk reactions and putting it out there, because you actually want to think of your president really thinking things through, not just having this kind of, you know, volatile reaction. And Twitter is so volatile. So, yeah, I do understand. So you grew up in Pennsylvania in a working-class town, ostensibly. But what I love about you is of course, you are just a superstar and you're worth billions of dollars and everything. And I'm still a businesswoman that's kind of working every hour that God sends. But I love your work ethic and I identify with so much of what you said. And, you know, I still have the same kind of attitude of you've got to be excited about it, because it's difficult to be motivated if you're not excited. And I always used to say, find a job that you love and then you never work a day in your life. So I really admire you for that. But you've had like a job since, I think, same as me, 13 years old or whatever. Yeah. And I'm writing a book at the moment and I'm talking about money's not just about money and what you can have. It's about the freedom that it represents. And I think
no question.
So you've got a job when you were 12. Yeah,
13. Yeah. When I was a kid, my goal, you know, was not to have to work, right? My dad did upholstery on cars. So if you had a rip in your car seat, you know, or you, you know, one of your restaurants, there was a rip in one of the chairs, you took it to him to sew it up and clean it up. And he was always very adamant to me that the most valuable asset you don't own is your time, you know, because he always had to be at work at 7 a.m., you know, and he worked on Saturdays at least until noon and would come home just exhausted. And his point to me always was, you know, if you can work for yourself, if you can go out there and create something, you can at least try to gain some level of control over your time. And that's been my goal ever since. I mean, when I was in college, I remember, you know, my favorite book was How to Retire by the Age of 35. And just because I was willing to live like a student, I didn't need to have the most amount of money. I just wanted to have the most amount of control of my time, because my first company, I went 7-8 years without a vacation. You know, my friends would go take off and do whatever. And I was just like, you know, business never stops. You may try to stop it, but never stops.
But also, when it's successful and you're on a, you know, you're hitting the kind of thing out the ballpark, so to speak, you're so excited by it. I'm always excited by a new project, you know. And for you, I was just kind of thinking, wow, to be that young and to be that ambitious is something I can definitely identify with. And I find it's just so invigorating. And I think if you look at work as a chore, then you're basically in the wrong job. I don't know how you feel about that. Are you still excited about all your projects that you do?
Yeah, I get excited because I don't have to do any of them, right? I'm blessed. You know, I get to pick and choose exactly what I do or don't want to do. But to me, business is like the ultimate sport. I actually wrote a little ebook called How to Win at the Sport of Business. And the whole point was, you know, it's like being a business athlete, right? And if you love your sport, it's not work, like you said. You just get in there and you do what you love. The competitive juices get going. You can't be an entrepreneur like you are, you know, with all the restaurants and all the projects and everything that you do without being competitive.
You heard it from the man. Absolutely. You know? Article's newest look features pops of pastels, jewel tones, and playful touches for a no-rules approach that's refreshing, bright, and inviting. Article combines the curation of a boutique furniture store with the comfort and simplicity of shopping online. Article's team of designers focus on beautifully crafted pieces, quality materials, and durable construction. They are dedicated to a modern aesthetic of mid-century Scandinavian, industrial, and bohemian designs. Fast, affordable shipping is available across the USA and Canada and is free on orders over $999. Plus, they have a 30-day return policy with simple returns and exchanges. I love the bedroom furniture that I got from Article. It was so easy. The bed frame and the nightstands, they match perfectly and really add a touch of modern elegance to the guest room. And when it all arrived, it looked exactly how it's portrayed online. So thank you for that. And the measurements were exact too. And the best part, the high quality without that price tag. I love that. So Article is offering my listeners, $50 off your first purchase of $100 or more. So go to article.com/Lisa and the discount will be automatically applied at checkout. That's article.com/Lisa to get $50 off your first purchase of $100 or more. Okay, you know, I read somewhere that you had a bar once or you worked in a bar. Is that true?
Yeah, I started a bar before I was 21 when I was in college. My friend Evan and I did. We used to throw parties there. One of the ways I paid for my junior year of college at Indiana University was there was this bar that wouldn't do much business, and I was underage, so I would rent.
That's not even legal, I was going to say.
Not legal at all.
But, what's the statute of limitations on this one?
Long gone. And I would just, you know, be a party promoter. And it got better and better and better. So then we bought the bar.
Okay, so tell the truth. Why did you really want a bar? Was it the same reason my husband? And was it so because it was so much easier to chase women around that bar? My husband, that's why he got involved in the bar. Is it just tell the truth?
Well,
now.
Not quite a truth. Yes and no, right? I wanted to see if I could do it, but it certainly did hurt when you're 20, 21 years old and you had the hottest bar on campus, right?
Exactly.
It had privileges.
Have you ever been pitched ideas of getting into the bar business or restaurant business again? Have you ever actually thought about becoming a partner, you know?
I did, right? So I came down to Dallas and I worked as a bartender at a bar called Elan when I first got to Dallas. And then I did that at night, but only for a couple of weeks. And then I got a computer job. That really was what I wanted to do. But once I started making some money in my first company, Micro Solutions, I invested in a couple bars. But I wasn't the proprietor, right? I was just the silent investor who got to come down and drink. And I learned my lesson. Either, you know, you've got to really trust somebody. You know what it's like. I mean, how many bars?
I've had 35 of them. But you know what? If I'd known that you were a good bartender, I could have had you on Vanderpump Rules.
I didn't say I was good. I never said I was good.
Well, none of my bartenders have been either, but they've still been on Vanderpump Rules. So, wow, that's really interesting. So then how did you get into owning the Dallas Mavericks? And I know diddly squat about basketball. I love watching it, but I know diddly squat about it. But how did you get into that? Was that just like a dream and ambition? I've made this much money, so now I've got to own my own team.
No, not at all. I never even crossed my mind that I could potentially own a professional sports team, just never, let alone an NBA team. And then after we sold broadcast.com and I made all that money and was able to actually have money in the bank, I was a season ticket holder. And I went with my girlfriend, now wife, Tiffany, and we were at opening night way back in the 99-2000 season. And I'm like, this sucks. There's nobody here. I could do a better job. And then it was like, whoa, wait a second. Now I can afford to actually put my money where my mouth is. And so I reached out to the owner through a mutual friend and ended up buying it.
Well, it's not that simple. How much did it cost, for goodness sake?
$285 million.
And you had that in your back pocket at the time? You're doing something, right?
You know,
right?
It's funny. I'll tell you a quick story. At that point in time, I had sold it for $5.7 billion in Yahoo stock. And the internet's stock market was crazy at the time. And so any one day, the Yahoo stock could go up $150, which meant like right there and then I just paid for the whole team.
Oh, wow. I love to hear that. You know what? I want you to explain to me a little bit about this kind of cryptocurrency, because I'm sure there's a lot of people that listen to, you know, my podcast that don't quite have a grasp on it. And I know you're huge kind of, you know, invested in the Doge. Explain it to me because what happens if you have all this money in cryptocurrency, but how do you spend it? That's what I know. You can spend it at Maverick. I know we can spend it in your merch shop.
Yeah, you can come to our shop and spend your Bitcoin, your Ethereum, your Dogecoin, whatever you want, you can. So I'll start with Bitcoin and I'll compare it to gold. You know, when you think about gold, nobody really buys it and holds it, right? You don't talk to people who have bricks of gold, right? They buy options or they buy ETFs or they buy the right to gold. And so it's very much virtual. What Bitcoin is, it's the digital equivalent of gold. Only because it's 100% virtual, it's a lot easier to buy and sell. And what makes it a little bit different is the creators of Bitcoin, which was only 12 years ago, give or take, decided they were going to put a limit on the amount of Bitcoin that would ever be created, which is 21 million Bitcoins. So they took all the best features of gold and they said, we're going to limit the amount because, you know, there's always people mining gold and there's always more gold, right?
For sure.
We're going to limit the amount. And we're going to make it available to people to buy and sell very simply by being online.
Did they expand on that or is it still at that?
It's still at 21 million. And that's what adds the scarcity value. And that's why Bitcoin, even over the last year or so, has gone from $4,000 to $54,000. Because, you know, one thing, you know, as you know, as an entrepreneur.
Supply and demand.
Yeah. I'm glad I had some. But, you know, supply and demand is undefeated, right?
Right.
When there's more demand than there is supply, prices go up. And that's what's happening. And Ethereum is a little bit different. It's another type of cryptocurrency, but it has a different type of application. So if Bitcoin is digital gold, Ethereum is for business-like applications. And it has this thing called a smart contract, which is really a computer program that allows you to authenticate and verify digital assets. Now, that sounds really complicated, but it's not. And that's what's given us NFTs.
Right.
All an NFT is a digital collectible. And so just like you might collect art, just like somebody else might collect trading cards, whatever it is, people collect sneakers, right? This is no different. It's just a digital version of that collectible. And it can be anything. I'm sure you've had discussions about NFTs.
Oh, absolutely. I find it fascinating.
And as long as you have a fan club of people who want, you know, your collectibles, just like, you know, you go on eBay, right, and you put in your name and there's all this stuff and you can't imagine why it's all there.
Yeah.
NFTs are just the digital version of those collectibles. That's all it is. And if you've got fans that want to buy it, they'll buy it.
And so what about Dogecoin? Did it have a hit just a few days ago?
Yeah. With Elon. Yeah.
So what's Dogecoin, happened with that? Has it rebounded or not?
It's about the same. It fell to where it was. So Dogecoin started off as a joke, right? That's, you know, I call it a doggy coin.
I love a coin with a doggy on it. I would take that currency. You know me, I've saved thousands of dogs. So that currency would be the perfect tender for my business.
Perfect. And actually, there's a company called BitPay. And if you wanted to take Dogecoin and Ethereum and Bitcoin, you can. That's what we use at the Mavericks. But so what's Dogecoin? Dogecoin started off as a joke in 2013. These two programmers said, all this cryptocurrency stuff is crazy. So we're going to make one that's built around the Shibu and we're just going to have fun with it. And they started just giving it away and they made billions of them, just gave them away. And people started collecting them, and then they started trading them. And then all of a sudden, it became a meme that became bigger, and people started buying and holding them. And because they were holding them, again, supply and demand is undefeated, the price went up.
Did they have a limit on them as well, Mark?
So not the same as Bitcoin. So there's a limit in how many new ones that they'll make per year. So they'll make 5.25 billion per year, which sounds like a lot, and it is. But compared to the however many hundreds of billions that there are out there, it's actually what's considered to be a low inflation rate. But here's what happened. So more and more people started buying it. I actually started buying it with my 11-year-old son, Jake. And I think we bought $30 worth when it was priced at under a penny. And then it went up to a nickel, no, 7 cents. And I'm like, Jake, I don't know if it's ever going to go higher.
How much did you buy with your son then? So
We bought $30 worth at that point in time. And so what it was, a penny was like 3,000 of Dogecoin, right?
Yeah.
And so when it got to 7 cents and we had you know, made $150, $200, right? We thought we were geniuses. And then it kept on going up and going up and going up. And what's happened now is it's gone from being a joke to so many millions of people around the world. Remember, it's not just the United States,
for sure,
but around the world owning it. It's almost become its own form of alternate currency. And so people, particularly those who have had a big gain in it, you know, they paid a nickel or a penny, and now it's worth 50 cents. They use it for currency because,
So can you tell me, why is it so temperamental that it could take such a dive with Elon? Why would that happen? Because that's, I think, what people worry about is how precarious that whole platform is.
And that is a concern, right? But it's no different than the stock market. If you look at the stock market, and it's the same with cryptocurrencies. When people say positive things, then more people buy. When people say negative things, you know, and what happened with Elon, there was this big run-up when, you know, it was announced he was going on Saturday Night Live because the assumption was he was going to pump it up, right?
Yeah.
And the price was going to go up. That rarely happens. In the stock market, they call it, you know, buy the rumor, sell the news.
Right.
You know, and what happened.
Yeah. Oh, wow. Okay, so I know that you've got a bit of a temper, right? And you've been fined multiple times for yelling at players and refs. Have you got any better with that, with dealing with people? And, you know, have you had a moment of self-reflection where you thought, okay, I've got to ease up on this, or do you just give them shit?
No, you know, it's funny. This year I have eased up because I feel bad for the refs because of COVID. Everybody's suffering. And so I don't want to raise as much hell as I usually do. But I just had this conversation with my kids, you know, and they're like, Dad, you know, the entire family, you're the one that's the most mercurial, right? You know, you're all over the place. I'm like, I am the sweetest, safest, nicest person, except for those 2 hours during a Mavs game. During those 2 hours, that's where I let it all out. And they're like, no, Dad. And I'm like, so that was our big argument at the Cuban family dinner last night.
Right. And so, well, I'm kind of believing both of you right now. I'm not sure whose side I'm on. But so can you tell me, how's COVID been for you? Because I know, you know, being a real energizer bunny myself, I was in this, you know, pretty substantial house. I mean, I don't think it's as big as your palace in Dallas, so to speak, but I'm in like 15,000 square foot, and I was trying to kind of keep it all going on my own. I had no help at all apart from outside in the garden, but we were petrified. Ken's 15 years older than me, so we were very, very kind of scared of the virus and very, very cautious.
I mean, from my perspective, number one is my family's health, first and foremost, everybody. But after that, you know, like you see me on Shark Tank, right? You know, one of my skills is being able to understand different businesses and different circumstances. So I really made a concerted effort to go out there and help small businesses, because every small business entrepreneur was terrified, right? Yeah. And then we saw the PPP program, and there were a lot of, you know, bad starts and stops and confusion. And, you know, a lot of small businesses that were working with big banks didn't get the support they needed. So I helped small businesses work with local community banks. And so literally I would go online on Twitter and LinkedIn and just say, who needs help with their PPP? How can I help you? Who's got questions?
It was very difficult. I mean, for us, we got PPP, and, you know, because to suddenly use all your life savings just to keep, I mean, just to keep your restaurant standing still with insurances and with rents, it was just astronomical. It was actually millions of dollars just to keep it standing still. So, yeah, so many of our friends went out of business. And I think 110,000 restaurants.
Westside Tavern was one of ours at the Landmark Theaters. And we paid literally for almost a year. We just paid the salaries, even though we did, you know, a tiny smidgen of delivery business. But we got to the point where actually the people there wanted to go out and get other jobs, and they felt bad. And so we ended up closing it.
Well, most of our staff, some of them we kept on that we could, but most of our staff went on unemployment. And now some of them don't even, they're thinking, well, just give us another month. We're enjoying being on unemployment. I'm like, no, you've got to come back to work. You know, I can't hold your job open forever. So we're kind of getting back, you know, up and running. But yeah, it was so sad. So many of our friends went up.
Doing well? Are you seeing people come back in most places?
Oh, absolutely. Pump is, you know, right on Santa Monica. I don't know if you come to Los Angeles, Mark.
I've been there. I've been to Pump, and I've been to the other one, Curver.
Tom Tom?
Yeah, I think it was Sir.
Oh, my God. When you come in again, you've got to let me know. We'll have dinner together. Absolutely.
But you know what's interesting to me in talking to small businesses? It was a catastrophe for a lot of entrepreneurs because they had to close, right?
Yeah.
But you haven't, the businesses that have survived and been able to stay open are now doing even better in like in Dallas, where things are open because there's less competition.
So what I want to ask you, have you ever had like a Beatles moment, you know, where that somebody passed on them and you think, oh shit, you know, like have you ever had people pitch you something and you thought, no, that's not going to work. And then suddenly it's the next. What's your biggest regret? That's what I want to know. What have you passed on?
Uber.
You didn't.
So the backstory is the guy who started Travis Bonick, he had a company called Red Swoosh that I invested in and helped him and that he sold.
Red Swoosh?
Red Swoosh. It was a technology company. And we made some money. We sold it for $18 million. Then he sent me an email, and I still have the email, from a company called Uber Cab. And he was like, we want to turn around the taxi cab business and put him out of business. And I'm like, Travis, great idea, but you want your valuation's too high because you're going to have to battle all the taxi cab commissions. Never came back to me again.
No, and how much is that worth? Don't know.
Don't ask, right?
Oh, good Lord. Okay, so what's one of the products that you thought, okay, I wasn't sure about, but then, you know, I actually kind of invested in it? And do you kind of take into consideration the emotion, the passion behind the people investing in it? Yeah. Or is it purely, you know, just the product?
Both. I mean, on Shark Tank, you have to take into consideration the people because that's primarily what we see, right? You know, we get to see a little bit of the product, but we get to talk to and learn a lot more of the entrepreneurs. And so in those deals, more so. And then in regular deals, I typically stick to the technology type industries. And so, you know, the idea, the technological capabilities are probably 50% together, and then not just one entrepreneur, but the team behind it. Because with those types of businesses, it usually takes a lot more than one person to really get it going. It's split. Sometimes it's the jockey and sometimes it's the horse. But on Shark Tank, it's more often than not the entrepreneur.
Right. So you invested in a business. Now this speaks to me because I'm dog crazy. I've got a couple of dogs sitting on me as we speak. But do you remember this business called Threads? Where people could dress their
clothes. Yeah.
I mean, so you invest in that. That has to be like a passion project or something. Or did you really take that seriously? And how well did that business do?
Well, they're off on their own now. Sometimes, so we get to do due diligence after the deal closes.
Yeah.
And sometimes what they say doesn't always match up. But the guys, the deal with Threads didn't close, but they were great entrepreneurs. And the product was great. And I loved it because we have a little mini Australian Shepherd. And so my kid, dressing up my kids and our dog, I thought was just the best thing ever.
Yeah.
And my kids liked the idea so much, but the Threads is still doing well.
So you've been like married now forever and a day. For how many years have you been married?
18 years.
Oh, wow. I've done a lot longer than you then. You've done 18. And so how do you find, because if you are not, you know, I wouldn't say you're a workaholic because I think that often has like a negative connotation. And I never want to be called that because that sounds like you're just nose to the grindstone, but you're passionate about what you do. So like, how do you sometimes say, okay, I'm going to switch that off now. I'm going to shut that down.
You know, my wife is incredible. She knew what she was getting into when she married me. And she's so independent that, you know, we can talk about anything. And if I have to work, I have to work. And she's got plenty on her own plate to do. And now that my kids are older, it's actually getting more fun with them, right? They're 11, 14, and 17. And, you know, there's nothing I like more than spending time with them. But the hard part is getting them to want to spend time with me. So that's its own challenge.
So what do you do to kind of seduce them into spending time with you? What's the kind of, you know, your best moments with them? I mean, I love the fact that you said to your 11-year-old, let's do this together, because it's a great little stepping stone. And when your dad's the champ at that, are they big fans of the Mavericks and things like that? Do they go to the games with you?
Yeah, they'll go to the games. And, you know, it's a little bit tougher now because of the pandemic, but in normal times, we'll all go to the games. And, you know, they have things that they like to do, like, for my 17-year-old daughter, it was doing TikTok dances with her to try to get her more followers.
I saw some of those. Okay, how long did it take you to learn the choreography of those?
Hey, like you, I've been on Dancing with the Stars, so I've got my moves down. Depends on the choreography, but I can usually pick it up.
And Dancing with the Stars one of the hardest things you've ever done?
Yes.
I tell you about it. They never tell you exactly how difficult it is because it put people off, right?
Yep, really hard. I was on season 5 way back when, and we would practice 6 to 8 hours a day. The good news was I lost like 25 pounds. The bad news was I was practicing all those hours just to not embarrass myself.
Yeah, I know. It's very stressful. And then when we did it, I did it a little while after you, a few years after you. But that was when they were doing 2 shows a week. They were both big shows and they were, you know, they were live. So you had one less day of rehearsal and another day of pressure. And it really was demanding. You would stand there thinking, oh, my God. Yeah,
yep.
And you're thinking, oh, my God, am I going to make a complete ass of myself out there? I know, I know. It was terrifying, right? I mean, if you had to do that again or speak at Congress, which would you rather choose?
Actually, I would do Dancing with the Stars again because it was such a challenge. It was the hardest thing I've ever done, literally.
Who was your partner?
Kim Johnson, who married Robert Herjavec, who's also on Shark Tank.
Oh, yes, of course. Yeah, she was on when I was on. Yeah, wow. Isn't that? Glenn Savchenko. He was new. He was a virgin on Dancing with the Stars. Well, not a virgin live, clearly. But he was, that was his first time on Dancing with the Stars. But I did have a great time doing it, I have to say. So, okay, my next question, because I've been, do you have any ambitions to be in politics, governor, or, you know, you're shaking your head, but I just think that this is something you would be so good at. You know how good reality stars are at politics.
Yeah, really, for better or worse, right?
I'd take your Twitter away from you. So you don't think you have any political aspirations?
I don't have the temperament. And for all the reasons we mentioned, because of my kids, you know, if I was single, I would do it because I don't want to put my kids through and have them relive anything I've ever done that was stupid in my life, which is plentiful. You know, there's just,
if you're going to relive anything stupid that you've ever done, can you do that now?
Yeah. You know, I don't need to put my kids through all that.
Yeah. Do you have any kind of regrets or what is something stupid that you've done? Because I can never imagine you doing anything stupid.
Oh, my God. No, I opened a bar before I was 21.
Oh, yeah, that's true. Oh, yeah, that's true. That was pretty stupid.
That just tells you. And then we would throw parties. Yeah. Don't even want to go there.
Well, I always think that it's quite lucky that those kind of evenings, normally you can't remember. So that's kind of like the band-aid.
I don't care if I remember. It's everybody else that remembers.
Exactly. That is so funny. Well, what's next for you? And is there anything that's coming up that you're really excited about? I'm sure there is.
Well, we started shooting Shark Tank again in July, which is cool, and I'm really excited. I love doing Shark Tank because, you know, as an entrepreneur, when you see particularly young kids get excited about starting a business, no matter what kind of business.
Yeah.
And that's why I do the show, because, anytime people are around me, somebody's coming up to me saying, oh, yeah, I've been watching Shark Tank since I was a kid and I started this business or that business or my kids are starting this business. And, you know, that makes me feel good because, you know, in this country, the more entrepreneurs we have, the better. That's what makes this country different. We're, you know, you've been around the world. We are a country of entrepreneurs.
Absolutely. The American dream. So when do you next come to Los Angeles? Because you've got to hit me up when you get here.
I don't know. It depends on the NBA playoffs. But yeah, it'd be fun to go to dinner. That would be a lot of fun.
Yes, I know, right? Gosh. I mean, there is so much that I'd love to talk to you about, but I think our time is up, unless there's anything you want to ask me and anything you want.
Oh, my God. There was one show you did that I, not Dancing with the Stars.
See, they weren't
quite. Oh, Tommy. Tommy, I saw that you were in.
Oh, my God. I was about 10 years old, wasn't I, when I did that? Roger Daltrey and Margaret.
I don't know, but I was like, what was that like? That's what it was. I was like, oh my God.
How did you even find that? Nobody's ever even mentioned that since I did it. I think the film Tommy with Roger Daltrey and Anne Margaret. Yes, I remember her singing and Ken Russell directed. It was amazing. I mean, I went to drama school, you know, as a very young girl. So I can only have been about, I don't know, when was it? Was it 72 or something around that time? 73 maybe?
Yeah, I remember it because I was just a kid too, right?
Yeah, and back you're 2 years older than me, I think.
Yeah, a couple years.
Yeah.
And, you know, you listen to music back then, The Who, I mean, my God, you know. And Tommy. You know,
Tommy was
about the pinball wizard.
It was so amazing, that story. And Ken Russell was, he's just, you know, he was iconic, really, to work with him. Yeah, I was a kid, and I remember I was on that film for a little while, and we just had a blast, you know. It was really, but who knew then? I don't think I quite understood the concept of what I was involved in, you know. But, yeah, I've had a very varied career, but it's been a kind of unbelievable roller coaster ride. You know, when I was first asked to do reality television, I had no idea that I would end up, you know, 12 years later with 4 shows and 500 episodes later. I just thought, well, maybe I'll try this, see, you know. But as I say, I'm kind of like you. I think we have that in common, that whatever I do, I want to do properly and I want to get invested in. And, you know, it's been like it's been a really kind of interesting journey, I have to say. And one of the things it's given me is just access Two, well, yep. like to people like you, too, to be able to say, I really want to talk to this guy. Can we get this guy? I really want to talk to him. I find him so interesting. And, you know, you could, I mean, even working with Trump. I mean, okay, I didn't contact him when he was president. But even having access to people in politics to, you know, get involved and talk about yep. things we're passionate about. I mean, I was involved with Trump because I was his judge on Miss Universe. I didn't quite agree with everything he was doing and standing for, but, you know, he did a lot of good as well.
I knew Trump for years, right? I've dealt with yeah. him for 20 years.
And when I was his judge, he was charming, and he was really, you know, amazing to work for, because I did it for 2 years on Miss Universe. But, yeah, it got a little bit carried away. But he did a lot of good as well, so, yeah. Anyway, it's so good to speak to you. Make sure if you come here, I do not want to catch you eating in Pump or Tom Tom or so, or even in Vegas without calling me, because, yeah, I'd really like to, you know, have a drink with you. If you come in with your wife, my husband and I, whatever, I think you're just amazing. I think you're an inspiration, and I think, you know, it's great to have examples and, you know, tenacity, but excitement about what you do. So thank you so much, and good luck with the new season. Of course, yep. It's been a complete pleasure. All right, thank you so much.
Thanks, everybody.
Hello, Kelty, and thank you for coming.
I'm obsessed that I'm here.
Double vaxxed?
Double vaxxed. It's as fabulous as you could imagine, everyone watching at home.
You're so funny. Actually, normally the ponies are over there.
Well,
and then they go down to the field, but they've gone down to the field early this morning, so you miss them.
Oh, God, I miss the ponies. That was the number one thing. Like, all my friends that are fans were like, you're going to go? Are you going to see the ponies?
Well, the ponies are actually just down there, so you
okay,
can...
Okay, so I'll probably sleep over, and then we'll be best friends and I'll move in.
Under the couch or something.
Okay, perfect. Good. Hi, Lisa.
Hi, darling. Thank you for coming.
What's new?
Well, with me, a hell of a lot. I'm in the middle of doing Vanderpump Rules. Vanderpump Dogs has just come out, so that's a big deal.
And Overserved is on.
Overserved still on,
and
yeah.
so cute.
It is. People have loved that. It's got a real feel-good factor.
So I have hot topics for you today. So this one hits home because, of course, the restaurant is in West Hollywood. Lady Gaga has a key to West Hollywood, and now you have another day to celebrate in West Hollywood, Born This Way Day.
Well, as you know, I'm friendly with Gaga, so yeah. it's great to see. And she's been a huge advocate for LGBTQ. So I really think it's time, you know, and to be celebrated like that, you know, why not? And I wasn't out yesterday because I was busy, but I saw her running down the street, like, you know, hugging people. And it was the Abbey, 30 years. That's a long time.
It's a long time. What do you think is like the special sauce of West Hollywood?
Well, it's a very progressive city. I used to sit on the board of the Chamber of Commerce, and I was always really impressed by how they really wanted the city to be kind of very forward-thinking. And the police department in West Hollywood are really good. They're really close to us. They're really responsive. I think they're fair. They're really... So, I mean, I like the city. Having had three businesses in the city, it's also, you know, it's been... very much LGBTQ haven.
Yes.
But now I've seen it change a little bit, that it's a little bit more mixed than mm-hmm. it was, which to me is an ideal world where people from all walks of life can come and embrace each other. And I think they've managed to do that.
People are raging. Like, we are so excited to be out. Like, Pump is like, whoa.
I know. And Tom Tom.
No, you can't get a reservation.
You can because you know me.
Okay.
But I literally, you know, we held off really in opening Tom Tom. We thought we wanted to do it right at the end because it was more bar orientated, or oriented, as you say, in America. So we felt, you know, let's do it right at the end. And it's been fantastic. It really has. And in another kind of 2 or 3 weeks, all the restrictions are going to be lifted.
It's going to be amazing. Okay, something I know you care so much about. I'm so glad we're here to talk about this because, I mean, we could not go on. Justin Bieber shaved his head.
I think it'd be more exciting if I shaved my legs.
Do you like a shaved head man?
Well, if a man's losing his hair, I think it's quite nice to go with it. I don't know what Justin Bieber's doing.
Do you think he's like, do you find him attractive? Are
no,
you like,
I've got things older than him in my fridge. Come on.
But like, can you understand why the Youngs love a Justin Bieber?
But I mean, I was obsessed with David Cassidy. And, right. You know,
right.
So yeah, absolutely. But I don't believe that he was being criticized, being culturally inappropriate.
Yeah, he had done dreadlocks for a couple weeks. And then people were like, hey, hey, hey. And so he didn't say, I shaved my head because you were calling me out on this. He just shaved his head. And, you know, when Justin Bieber does anything, whether
they
he's
like—
They
like to keep it fresh. They like to be the topic.
Yes, and it's hot. Center of it. Summer. Yeah. You know what I mean? He's like, he is getting his peaches in Georgia. He's getting his weed from California now. He needs to like have a new look.
Well, I think he can do anything at this point, and people love him regardless.
Okay, so I wanted to ask you this. Machine Gun Kelly, who is so tall, and I know you don't even know who that is, but he has a big following. MGK.
Machine Gun Kelly.
Okay, I've heard the name, but... He's a singer, songwriter. He is...
Can you imagine me...
At a Machine Gun Kelly concert?
Rosa thinking, I've got to go to a Machine Gun Kelly concert. Okay, I'm in. Tell me about it.
You're both very authentic and you're both very outspoken. And you don't really play by the rules. So you
Well, the Vanderpump rules.
Yeah, you're the Vanderpump gun. No, machine. Anyway, okay.
Whatever.
So, you know, he's dating Megan Fox and they're like in love.
Right.
Wait, I need to pull up the picture for you. Hold on. Let me grab my phone.
What did she do?
Anyway, she's so hot. Well, the dress. Megan Fox.
Well, she's utter perfection.
I mean, insane.
What on earth is that?
So he's
she's got everything out. Hold on a second.
It's all out, babe.
What's his tongue?
He's got a black tongue because there's like a lyric in the song. And so he came. But then I'm like, how did you know when you were going to get there? How did you get the tongue black? Did your teeth get black? Were you worried about your acceptance speech? Because this was at the Billboard Awards. So he won. And I was like, this is stressful. And
he
then like,
won?
Did they make out?
With that black tongue.
She looks hot though.
Yep.
That body is.
Well, that body is, yeah.
And honestly, Lisa, like I was sitting here, I was like, we're going to talk about the body. But then I was like, I can see why Lisa's been married so long because your cleavage is insane.
Oh, they're real, but hers look real too.
They're beautiful.
Yeah, right?
Anyway, yeah.
She looks good, but I'm not sure about the black tongue. The only time I like a black tongue is on a chow chow.
And mic drop. But do you like them as a couple? You don't even...
I don't really know enough about them, but I mean, she's so gorgeous. She really is. She's like pretty exceptional. But the black tongue, no. God, I wouldn't want to kiss anybody with a black tongue, would you?
No, and the thing is that
Look how white your teeth are. Can you imagine?
Exactly.
That would ruin your day.
Do you know how much money I spent on getting these teeth white?
So you're not going to make out with somebody. Yeah.
You know, and also I hate violence, so I'm not going to make out with anyone named Machine Gun. You know what I mean? That's like a zero for me.
I'm with you on that one, but I probably won't get the option, so I probably don't have to worry
about it. Nobody's asking to make out with me. I can like confirm that
I'm
to you.
Not me.
I mean, only the dogs.
Exactly.
Well, you're wonderful. Thanks for having me again.
No, give me more. There must be some other stuff. What else have you got? Well, let's talk about the Ben Affleck and J-Lo thing.
Did you talk about it already?
I have talked about it, but I'd like you to weigh in on it.
I have a whole thought about this.
Okay. I can see that evil glint in your
eye. No. I think that like everyone's like, you know, no one works harder than Beyonce. No one works harder than Oprah. No one works harder than Jennifer Lopez's PR team. This is an incredible 360. If you're training people PR-wise, like what to think and like what story to follow, the A-Rod thing went away and they were like instantly, I didn't even have time to grieve that engagement as a fan.
Yeah, but I don't think they would do it for the reason of PR, do you?
No. It's not a PR stunt. I'm just saying when they get the call, like they've broken off the engagement and like A-Rod is out. And like, what are we going to talk about? They didn't let us talk about that breakup at all. There was no time.
So you needed the grieving process to actually lament over the relationship.
Their best moments, their best red carpet look. Where was the gallery?
No, I think because he misbehaved, she was like absolutely just desserts. And as I said, don't get mad, get even. And what better than to throw Ben Affleck in his face?
And Ben's looking great.
Exactly. And he shouldn't have been doing what he's doing.
No. And I love this. There's always something about an old flame. Have you ever gone back to an old flame? I guess not.
Well, I have to be married
to the old flame
years,
forever.
I could get myself in trouble.
Something about, other than you, who's
do you
like,
think if you sleep with an old flame, do you think that basically it doesn't count? It's kind of nice
on the notch?
In a way because you're
doesn't
not.
Count.
It doesn't count.
No. Same dick.
It probably counts to the person. Did you just say same dick?
Same dick.
Oh, come on.
No.
No, I mean, I guess, yeah. But I mean, it... it's going to hurt the other person more, the fact that you're going backwards to something that you might
like. Well, and he's so cute and he has big muscles and he's like Boston. He's like just, you know, he's Batman.
He's Batman.
Well, he was Batman, not anymore.
No, I know, but is that attractive too? I guess.
I mean, here's the thing. J-Lo, in my eyes, can do no wrong. She is the biggest star. She's so cool.
Yeah.
I love her career. I love that she's defying age. I don't know. I don't think it's going to last, but I love this for her. And the album's going to be incredible.
Why don't you think it's going to last?
Because I don't think there's anyone on the planet that is good enough for Jennifer Lopez. That's
really
how I feel. I feel like this is a Rihanna situation.
Oh, well, Rihanna said in Vogue that I'm actually her lady crush. Come on, that's pretty cool.
Shut up.
She did. She said in Vogue.
Have you met?
No. It's probably better if I don't.
Well, no, like, I don't know. I mean, but it's like that kind of lady. Like, who's going to marry Rihanna? Like, she's too great.
Well, I feel honored the fact that she called me out for being her
lady crush.
Thanks, Rihanna.
Yeah, exactly.
With J-Lo, though, she's still a woman that has children and needs satisfying somebody to love her. And obviously, A-Rod really dropped the ball there. So, I don't know, maybe she does kind of lament over what went wrong. What did go wrong with Benefit? Was he running around or something? Or was he drinking and partying too much? Do you remember?
I don't really remember, but like I think the heat was just on them.
Yes, but also maybe he hadn't grown up enough.
He was a boy.
Because I think he was a bit of a bad boy, wasn't he? And it takes him a while to grow up. So maybe he kind of realizes now what he missed and he's ready to shape up.
And shape up he did. Those biceps, they're like coming out
I'm
of the little house in Miami.
About
and I was
that
like,
part of him.
I was like, did you just do some push-ups?
Where was the little house in Miami? When they were coming down like that, what
the
kind of
stairs.
Little, where was that?
She has a big cheesy green on. I don't know. It was like some kind I don't know. I wasn't there, but
yeah,
like
her hair was all over the place.
She had like a little the hairstylist had not been in to put the extensions
her head
in.
Yes. Type of hair. Yeah, I get the message. Yeah. Well,
but
anyway, whatever
boots
she's doing.
Boots a knocking, Lisa.
I wonder how pissed off he is. Hey, Rod.
It's good to see you, Lisa. Oh, can I tell all your fans to listen to Lady Gang Podcast, please?
Yes, of course.
Please listen to Lady Gang Podcast. We have Lisa on. I'll put that episode up to the top.
Yes. No, please listen to Lady Gang.
Talked about penises.
Yeah, and we had so much fun. Mm-hmm. So thank you so much for coming. I can come back. Don't be a stranger.
Maybe see the ponies. Bye.
So to wrap up today's episode, we have a special fan call and it's from Jackie Mandel, who's Howie Mandel's daughter, and she wants me to prank call him. So let's see what she's got.
Hello.
Hello, Jackie. This is Lisa Vanderpump.
Oh my gosh, I'm such a big fan. I am fangirling right now.
You are so sweet. You've got to actually come on my podcast. But
Yes. The answer is yes.
Okay. So what are we doing to your poor father, your poor unsuspecting father?
No. It's not my poor father.
So oh.
My dad is a prankster. He plays pranks on everyone else. So it's about time.
Oh, it's payback.
It's payback.
Nice. Yeah. I'm all for payback. Let's do it. So what are we going to say exactly?
So he already knows. My daughter actually went on Ellen with him and sold Girl Scout cookies. And because it was on Ellen, she sold a crazy, crazy amount of Girl Scout cookies. And when you sell Girl Scout cookies, you also get prizes. And we decided instead of getting the prize to donate the prize money to an organization. Now, the only organization they had available was to save horses. So that's what we did. But he doesn't know that. I'm going to tell him that we use the money to give to Vanderpump Dogs, to rescue dogs. And accidentally, we instead gave the money for adoption fees. And we have, I don't know, 11 or 12 dogs showing up at our house.
All right, then. And they're on their way because they're in the van. I'm just so thankful that you've taken them because, you know, and they actually, all 11 of them, or 12 of them actually, get on really, really well. I mean, we'll do it like that, right?
Okay, yeah.
I've actually met him. I sat next to him at Simon Cowell's birthday dinner a few years ago. He probably doesn't know that, but it doesn't matter.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Great.
Okay.
So he can talk to you. Okay, let me put you on the phone with him.
Okay.
Hello.
Hello?
Hello?
Dad, you're on...
Jackie?
Yeah. Wait, Dad, you're on with Lisa Vanderpump right now on the phone.
Oh, hi.
Hi. Hi, Howie.
I'm a big fan.
Oh, you're so sweet. I actually sat next to you at dinner years ago at Simon Cowell's birthday dinner years ago. But I'm just so thankful for everything you've done because the dogs are all on the way now. So I wanted to say thank you to you personally because, you know, having a rescue organization and save so many thousands of dogs, for somebody to reach out and donate is just so, so kind. And you're going to love each and every one of them. I mean, they are amazing and they all get on so well. So thank you so much. It really does mean a lot.
Wait.
Huh?
I don't know.
What?
I didn't get a chance to explain to my dad.
What?
What happened?
What do you mean?
Dad, I wanted you to come on the phone to talk to Lisa and maybe we can figure something out because remember how Abby was on Ellen and sold those Girl Scout cookies?
Yeah.
Yeah, so she sold a lot and earned a lot of money and we decided it would be best to donate it back to an organization and I'm such a huge fan of
Lisa Vanderpump. Thank you.
Yeah, and I'm like shaking right now. I love your rescue and everything.
Yeah.
We decided to
Well, it's with people like you that really make a difference. I mean,
What did you do, Jackie?
I donated to her rescue for the dog. Uh-huh. I think instead of donating, I accidentally paid for adoption fees for, was it 11 or 12 dogs?
Well, it was 12, but only 11 can make it, but... I mean, they're on their way now.
On their way. What does on their way mean?
Well, they're in the van. They're in the Vanderpump Dogs van. What am I like? Am I getting somebody in trouble here? Huh?
Wait. Can I?
Shall I call back? Ooh.
No. Can I ask a question? I don't know. I'm confused.
Uh-huh. No. Okay. Well, I'm confused. So the dogs are in the Vanderpump Dogs van because...
There's a van filled with dogs. And where is this van?
It's on the way to Calabasas. Van? Isn't that where you live? Well, I have the address. Huh?
I gave them your address, Dad.
Wait.
There's a Shih Tzu and a Pekingese, which are really small.
I can't take...
What?
Does your mother know about this, Jackie?
I didn't know till right now.
Hold on a second. I feel like...
Can I just ask a question? You're talking about... excuse me, Lisa.
No problem.
11 dogs are coming to my house now?
Oh, hold on. I've just got a text, and they're actually near your gate. So they... them, right?
11 dogs are coming. They're going to be out of the van at my... I can't do this. The 11 dogs are coming. Jackie, what did you do?
There's only a couple of big ones.
I have two dogs here.
So what's 13? What's 13?
Are you being serious?
No, I mean, I'm in a position where...
So what's 13? I have two. So what's 13? That's like saying... I can't
Jackie? Well, I don't understand how this has all got so confused because you filled out the thing for 11 adoption.
Or it was, ordered 11 dogs?
No, Jackie.
I can't take the dogs. And I don't
Well, you haven't met them. Howie.
That's like saying I have a wife. What's another 13 girlfriends?
No, it's no comparison. I've had 11 dogs at a time. These dogs also get on really well. There's only a couple of big ones.
Dad, I made a mistake and I'm really, really sorry, but it is a rescue and you can't.
Well, who's going to rescue me from your rescue? This is not a joke. This is, seriously, I can't.
Do you want me to take a couple back? Would that help?
What do you mean, will that help? I have 9 dogs? I'm going to have 9 dogs and my 2 and you're just going to drop them here? I don't even know, like, this is.
But you said that they've got a big garden that.
Well, I can take 4 of them, Dad, because I can't take all of them.
I don't want one more. First of all, you know that your mother has allergies. These are hypo. I don't even know who these dogs are. Like, do they have shots?
Oh, of course. No, they all have shots. They're, Yeah, they all chip. They have shots, spayed, neutered.
Instagram. We have rattlesnakes and we have coyotes, and it's hard enough. Even when I walk the two dogs, I can't let them in the backyard without a leash. What am I going to do with 13? This is crazy.
Well,
and they're here.
No, they're outside the gate.
They're at the gate.
But they really need a home.
Lisa, I don't want to be.
No, Howie, I don't want to inconvenience you, but they're.
To my daughter. Why?
But they're going to their forever home.
Jackie.
What?
Oh, I don't want to get you in trouble. Jackie, I don't want to get you in trouble.
Too late. You know, she's an adult and she does things. She has her own kids and everything, but I'm not. How can I have a van load of. I'm not Noah.
But we.
I don't live in an ark. I can't have.
No, but we've got like 43 dogs at the moment in the shelter. So the fact that you've taken 11 just changes everything. Jackie, they're outside your gate. I've just. Texted them. Jackie, they're outside your gate.
Jackie?
What?
You come over to my house right now and you deal at the gate with these people. You come over.
Howie, you've been Vanderpunk.
No, I'm hanging up.
You've been Vanderpunk, Dad.
Wait, it's a joke.
Dad, it's a joke, Dad. You've been Vanderpunked. He's gone. He's gone. He's never going to talk to me again.
Is he gone?
He is gone.
Did he hang up?
Huh? Call him back. He's going to hate me forever.
Okay, I'll call him back.
Oh, my God.
Hello?
Daddy?
Daddy?
No, don't call me back. I'm in my car.
Daddy, you've been Vanderpunked. You're Vanderpunked, Daddy.
You're pranked. It's not real, Dad.
I wouldn't.
I'm sitting in my car right now.
Take your blood pressure.
Yeah, I'm not a young man. You don't do that to your father. You don't do that, Jackie.
Jackie, well done. You got him going, girl.
Got me good.
No, okay. Listen, no dogs outside. No dogs outside. But if ever you're in the business for a rescue dog, we're right here for you.
But no, now, Lisa, next time, if you want to prank anyone else that you can think of, you come on our podcast and we will prank them for you.
Oh, yeah. There's about... a dozen housewives that I'd like to get going.
Let's do something on my podcast. I have to regain my
composure.
My blood pressure. And my heartbeat. I'm getting out of my car now. I don't know what I was going to do at the gate. I was so mad at you, Jackie.
Oh, guys, thank you for a blast.
You're a very good actress.
I was literally laughing my socks off. But you know what? Thank you for being such a good sport. But yeah, if ever you want to adopt a dog, seriously, I will not send you 12, though. I will not send you 12.
Well, we love you, and I love to hear that it was just a prank, and you got to come on our podcast.
Absolutely, I'll be there.
You owe me.
You guys. I do.
Bye-bye.
Bye. Bye, darling. Bye. Bye. Oh, my God, that was hilarious. That was truly hilarious. I really do think he bought it. Oh, my good Lord. Okay, thank you to Jackie, who kind of instigated this naughtiness with Howie Mandel, her daddy. And thank you to Mark Cuban. Really enjoyed the conversation. And also thank you to Kelty. We had a blast. Anyway, rate and review Cast Media's podcast, All Things Vanderpump, wherever you listen to your podcast. You can also subscribe to All Things Vanderpump on YouTube and watch the video releases every week. Thanks a lot, guys.